Hello and welcome to this special show on Rajya Sabha TV, Reset India. I'm Vishal Dahiya, and here we talk about the big ideas which are required to give a push to the Indian economy as well as to tackle the challenges which India is facing along with the rest of the world as well in the post-pandemic scenario. So today we're going to talk about vocal for local. Now, what's exactly vocal for local? What is the theme? What are the focus areas? Before we start the discussion, let's understand what are the key focus areas in vocal for local. And as far as vocal for local is concerned, the focus is on greater recognition of investment in local knowledge, local technology, and local talent as well. These are the key areas where the focus will be, and this particular concept further amplifies the Make in India campaign, which was launched in 2014 when Prime Minister Narendra Modi took charge for his first term in power. And the Make in India campaign focuses on manufacturing locally, and this is something which Vocal for Local further takes forward. Another aspect here is focus on promotion of local brands and domestic manufacturing. As I was pointing out earlier, that domestic manufacturing is something which is the focus area for Make in India campaign as well. And this is where Vocal for Local becomes really, really important and significant. It also talks about, the manufacture of value-added products will definitely create more jobs at the local level. So another key benefit here is creation of jobs, something which is really, really important when we are talking about the turnaround of the economy. So these are some of the key specific areas, key focus areas when we talk about Vocal for Local. And before we move further and before I introduce the guests to you as well, let's listen in to the Prime Minister as well, who've been repeatedly talking about Vocal for Local. And the latest comment came in from him during the recent Mann Ki Baat. So let's listen in what exactly Prime Minister Modi is talking about as far as Vocal for Local is concerned.
मैं देश के manufacturers और industry leaders से आग्रह करता हूं, देश के लोगों ने मजबूत कदम उठाया है, मजबूत कदम आगे बढ़ाया है, Vocal for Local ये आज घर घर में गूंज रहा है. ऐसे में अब यह सुनिश्चित करने का समय है कि हमारे प्रोडक्ट्स विश्व स्तरीय हो. जो भी ग्लोबल बेस्ट हैं वो हम भारत में बनाकर दिखाएं. इसके लिए हमारे उद्यमी साथियों को आगे आना है, स्टार्टअप्स को भी आगे आना है.
So there it is, the Prime Minister himself once again underlining the need for Vocal for Local, and clearly, focusing on those areas which I was earlier talking about in terms of ensuring that local talent and local manufacturing hubs and local technology is something which is given due prominence as far as Vocal for Local is concerned. Let's now take the discussion forward and let me first introduce the guests also with us, prominent personalities joining us today on the show. We have Mr. C.K. Ranganathan. He is the Deputy Chairman of CII Southern Region. We also have with us Dr. Arvind Veermani, former advisor, Ministry of Finance, and also Chairman of eGrow Foundation. Dr. Veermani, let me begin with you, and let's begin with a basic question here. Let's, to make our viewers understand it much better, let's start by understanding why Vocal for Local is a very key concept when we talk about India's economic growth here. Dr. Veermani, you will have to unmute yourself, sir.
So there are many aspects of this issue. So let me give some of the dimensions. I hope I don't miss them, but we can take up later. So the basic foundation of this is competitiveness. So India has to be competitive with the rest of the world, both with respect to exports, imports, domestic production. So that's really the key ingredient to all this. Now, if we another aspect is marketing. And here I take up, you mentioned the Prime Minister. Mm-hmm. One of the examples he has been giving is that we have a diversity of various types of production down at the local level. And the problem is marketing. So this whole thrust on startups, on e-markets, etc., and to bring them all together in this concept of Atmanirbhar Bharat, to connect local craftsmen, local products, handmade products, which are very, which have a big potential markets. So to connect the local with the entire domestic Indian market and to the foreign markets. So the branding and marketing aspect which you mentioned. Mm-hmm. As far as the productivity is concerned, the element of one important element of competitiveness is scale. So this is particularly stands out when we compare China and India. What you see is that the scale of manufacturing of any product in China, and which is why they are competitive abroad, is much, much larger than us, mm-hmm. both in terms of capital and labor. So the two aspects which are directly designed to address this are the new labor reforms that have been put in place and the new PLI scheme which has been introduced.
Okay.
So there are many other aspects which we can take up, but that I would say is broadly, you know, to make it address both the domestic competitiveness issues and the international aspects of it.
Okay.
So all these aspects coming. Just as a side, I would like to add, which is also kind of related. Mm-hmm. I had once written an article saying, let's extend Make in India to Educate in India. And the new education policy, for example, actually does this. It makes it possible to bring back, you know, a lot of people in India are studying abroad. Besides the money they pay to actually study in the university, their living expenses also in a way get transferred. So if we could educate in India, the living expenses, at least at the minimum, would all be spent in India, plus it would generate employment. So all these okay. aspects, there are many different aspects, but this is another one. And the new okay. education policy tries to address this issue. So
okay.
a whole
okay.
host of reforms, a few selective programs, and many different aspects.
Okay, definitely. And all these aspects, as you're pointing out, Dr. Veermani, are correlated. You know, all these policies are correlated. Let me bring in, Mr. Ranganathan here as well. Mr. Ranganathan, you know, from your point of view, the significance of concept of vocal for local, how significant it is?
I think this is very significant. One of the topmost initiatives of our Honorable Prime Minister. I must say that this is the most need of the hour, and we were very badly looking for such kind of a thing for a long time. This pushes, this is a need and impetus for Indian industry. I think this is very, very good, and very happy to hear that, because I can tell you every 1,000 rupees of a product bought by any Indian consumer, you can imagine that creates at least half a day job of an Indian. And the same thing if you buy, that is it's a chain of value addition in the chain, because the one, it is not one product end you see, but there is slew of this thing, value chain, mm-hmm. various manufacturers in that to support to produce a particular product. So the as a whole, if you look at a minimum of half a day wage of this thing, labor cost, labor, this thing can be, they say, unearthed, you know, 1,000 rupees spent. Same way, if a person buys an imported product, anything related to imported components in that, mm-hmm. you are creating job elsewhere in the world. I think the might of Indian companies, India, Indian economy is directly proportional to more job creations. And the more money spent, created here, is to be spent here. So I think it is important, vocal for a local, you buy Indian-made goods. In the long run, buy Indian goods, Indian brands.
Okay.
I think that is also very, very important. Indian brands, they will make money, they'll make profits, they'll reinvest here. But overseas brands, I think they also require, because to be very competitive, I think they bring in a very healthy competition, pushes us for a higher order technologies, and that is very healthy. But at the same time, I think once they make profit, they will repatriate. to overseas.
Okay.
So
okay.
Limited amount of investment will be there. So I would very strongly advocate vocal for local is the best thing that can happen for startups and for all the Indian manufacturers for creating more jobs within India.
Okay. Okay, definitely. That seems another plausible explanation why it is really, really significant, both from the industry's point of view, from the company's point of view, as well as connects with what Dr. Vimani was earlier saying. Dr. Vimani, you were earlier, you know, in your first response, you spoke about how labor reforms, new policies, all these are seemingly aimed at giving that push to the local talent, local technology, as well as, you know, the local manufacturing prowess as well. And bringing that at par with the world quality. Now, when we talk about policies, Dr. Vimani, where do we stand in terms of the policies to push local, vocal for local, and you know, what needs to be done from here onwards? Because this needs a much greater, larger push in today's specific scenario as well.
Policies, you said, what are the policies? Now, I have already mentioned two which connect labor and education. A third one, which is in the news, this is agricultural policies. Now, agricultural growth, diversification of agricultural exports depend on diversification of both the crops and a whole slew of development of allied industries.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the wheat, rice, sugar economy is kind of, you know, has reached the limits of its usefulness. There is little scope for, you know, major expansion, exports, and so on.
Okay.
A lot of exports we are doing on those items are all subsidized. So you're basically subsidizing foreigners to buy these things, which is actually a waste of resources. So the agricultural reforms were designed to. Now, they may have some small errors or problems which can be easily be corrected. But the basic objective and requirement of the reforms was to make this diversification possible.
Mm-hmm.
So what do we mean by diversification? There are all kinds of exotic fruits, vegetables. People are now using coarse grains for snacks. The coarse grains have disappeared because of this wheat, rice, sugar emphasis, which are no longer considered the healthiest things to eat. So tubers, for example, we talk about potatoes, which are a mm-hmm. crop, but shakarkandi, which is a traditional, you talk about local. Shakarkandi has been found to be very good for diabetics. So there are a whole huge host of new crops, seeds, which people are eating in the world, even in India, for healthy reasons. So this whole diversification
mm-hmm.
by making the demand side of agriculture more competitive, more open, and more open to innovation, organic foods, et cetera, et cetera. Instead of being stuck in that old rut,
mm-hmm.
There are lots of new products. Entrepreneurs will now connect both to the All India market and to the international market to develop these new supply chains. You know,
okay.
Exports or All India thing doesn't happen by itself.
Mm-hmm.
You need that whole supply chain. You need to connect the markets, you need to develop the markets, then only the supply chain develops. Otherwise, it's too risky and not profitable. So that's another example.
Okay.
You know, we can go on to other examples, but yeah.
Technology is one part, Dr. Vimani. You know, technology is something which can be put to good use, and you specifically mentioned as far as this agriculture sector is concerned. But if you look at other sectors also, you know, nowadays there's a talk about the toys Make in India sector. There needs to be a lot of push there. We are almost just 1-2% of the overall world trade as far as toys are concerned. But there is a lot more which can be done. Similarly, there are other sectors as well.
Yeah, good, very good question. So this whole labor-intensive products we have missed out on. Why? Because we are not a part of those supply chains. You know, the international data shows that most of the exports, see, we are all in niche markets. We produce very well, we are efficient in that, but specialized small markets all over the world. So what we are missing out on as a country are these big supply chains.
Mm-hmm.
So one, we know that most of the exports now go through supply chains. And secondly, multinational corporations are channels for 50% of these supply chain exports. So you have to focus on FDI also. And there's whole liberalization of FDI, which has taken place. is part of that superstructure. You know, I said it's all interrelated. Mm-hmm. That structure which will get us to attract more FDI from export-oriented supply chains and to push these labor-intensive exports, as you mentioned.
Okay.
But this also has some remaining things which must be done. For example, the external sector, you know, we have raised some tariffs over the last 2 years, but I don't think a comprehensive view has been taken.
Okay.
You have to be very careful. See, we don't want to get into that old system of raising tariffs on one item, then raising it another, et cetera, down the chain and creating inefficiencies. So one has to be very careful in devising a short-term protection along with the PLI. That's another integrated thing.
Mm-hmm.
You see, there is no point putting a higher tariff, let's say, on an auto import
mm-hmm.
when there is no production, because that will just create less jobs in the user industry. So on the other hand, if you integrate it with the PLI, you can start making a component at a higher scale
mm-hmm.
and then protect it for a little while till that becomes successful and profitable
okay.
and competitive.
Okay. Okay. So all of these things will have to move in tandem, as Dr. Veermani is pointing out. Mr. Ranganathan, from industry's point of view, all these aspects, all these key focus areas when we talk about different sectors for boosting local or regional development or vocal for local, which the concept which we started with and the focus area here. So from your point of view, you know, and industry's point of view as well, what are the key focus areas which need to be, you know, the areas or the sectors where both the industry and the policymakers need to put their best foot forward on?
I feel one of the important things, if you look at ease of doing business, which government is rightfully addressing, I think more and more reforms that's coming in that's helping us, whether it is be it labor reforms, all these things are going to make the life of industry much more easier and competitive. And that is very, very important. And also international companies wanting to come and set shop here, they are happy because they are looking at multiple countries. And India has to be competitive when we welcome them for creating jobs. I think that is one angle. Ease of doing business is one thing the policymakers have to do, and they are doing a good job. And we need to move up the rank. I think ideally we should come below 25 this thing. Ease of doing business would be nice. If you do it in the next 2 years' time, that would be fantastic. The other one, I think, from the industry side is to boldly invest in betting big on the vocal for local and on technology, R&D.
Mm-hmm.
I think that is one of the things that Indian industry need to believe in R&D and consistently invest money behind that. Because that is where I think you can make your own technology. Otherwise, you are import dependent.
Mm-hmm.
Either you import the finished good or you import the raw materials. Quite a lot of raw materials are imported. And that is one thing we have to do. The other one, I would say, we go and import from neighboring countries because we believe India is costly. Because we don't give the quantum of volume, it is expensive. We go and import it from China. I think Indian industry also shows some patriotism and ensure that we encourage local industries and buy locally, and though a little bit costly, I think that creates a lot of jobs. And eventually pave way for making more and more volume of this thing, the material, the cost will come down.
Okay.
So it's a chicken and egg. So these are the things that Indian industry must do, is my viewpoint. And more startups are required. More and more startups, I think we should do. The startup ecosystem need to be far more facilitated. And we need to, I think, as a community and as a kind of society, we need to encourage failures. Failure is not fatal. I think that is very, very important. The societal need, the mindset need is one of the important things that's required.
Okay.
That will go a long way, because I would be very happy 100 people passing out of college or not dropping out of school or something, if we can say that 25 people will end up creating a business and at least attempt a startup. And that will be the best day India can welcome to.
Okay. Okay, definitely. Entrepreneurship, as Mr. Ranganathan is pointing out, is the key as far as Vocal for Local is concerned. More people trying to find solutions to the problems which we are facing, and also boosting that regional development. That brings me to the last concluding one to Dr. Veermani here. Dr. Veermani, the road ahead we're talking about, you know, this is one area wherein every time we try and, you know, make an assessment, we realize that, yes, this is the area and in specific sectors and lot many of them that a lot could have been done. And now that the focus is shifting towards this particular aspect, how do you see the road ahead?
Well, you know, given the point of time we are in, the next big effort will obviously have to be in the budget. So it kind of relates to that. So, you know, given that the budget deals with taxation and the fact that, you know, we've had corporate tax reform in September of last year. So I think the focus has to be on doing some kind of similar tax reform to ease. I agree completely with Mr. Ranganathan that to ease the ease of doing business for the small industry startups. And, you know, they are less affected by the corporate income tax structure than by the direct tax code. So I would hope, and, you know, there was a committee set up by the government which a year or two ago, which has already given its report, etc. So reforming, you know, we have a direct tax code with a 19th century code, I mean, 20th century, and we are trying to build digital startups in the 21st century. So I think it's overdue that a simpler, rational and direct tax code, which is up to global standards, is constructed. So I think that's the most important pending job to put a level playing field. You know, we talk about local. We are going to talk even about small entrepreneurs, local entrepreneurs in the districts. Think you don't want them to have this burden of complicated GST, for example, a complicated code. And I'm not talking from my head, I've talked to small people who find it a huge burden to look through all those taxes, etc. So making, and that's not so difficult. It's just getting down there and maybe addressing some vested interests. There are always vested interests who will oppose this, but I'm sure this government is strong enough to take them head on.
Okay, there it is. Thank you so much, Dr. Veermani, as well as Mr. Ranganathan, for sharing your views on this very important aspect when we talk about India's growth and Indian economy's growth, being vocal for local, that is, focus on regional and local development. Basically, bringing back the focus on local talent, local technology, and ensuring that local products are given due prominence. And we have the power to go ahead and do that. We've done it in various sectors. And as our panelists were pointing out, more focus needs to be given on several other sectors. We'll wait and see as to what exactly is in the store as far as this particular aspect is concerned in the next budget. But in the run-up to the budget, we will keep on bringing you all aspects wherein the resetting is required. That is why we call this show Reset India. Keep watching Rajya Sabha Television.